monastics are invited to come up and offer a chant.
The Sangha is invited to come back to our breathing so that our collective energy of mindfulness will bring us together as an organism, flowing as a river with no more separation. Let the whole Sangha breathe as one body, listen as one body, chant as one body, transcending the boundaries of a delusive self, liberating us from the superiority complex, the inferiority complex, and the equality complex.
From the depths of understanding, a flower of great eloquence blooms, the Bodhisattva stands majestically upon the ways of birth and death, free from all of stability of Buddha sitting is seen in mountains and rivers. How splendid is the worshiping, how beautiful the light that shines forth from Buddha's brow, illumining the six-star path. To the Nagapushpa assembly we will go to continue the true teachings and practices. We take refuge in the Buddha, ever present. The Dhamma jewel is infinitely lovely, the precious words of Buddha, like fragrant flowers floating down from the heavens. The wonderful Dhamma is plain to see. It is recorded luminously in three transparent baskets. From generation to generation, and in the wind
Dear respected Thay, dear brothers and sisters, dear friends, if we can support our sound brothers and sisters to turn off our cell phones and our electronic devices before the talk so it wouldn't interfere with our microphones, that would be very helpful. Yeah, con kính bạch xong, con kính thưa đại chúng, con xin đại chúng mình yểm trợ mình tắt điện thoại di động và các điện tử để nó không mà ảnh hưởng đến hệ thống microphone của sư ông. Dạ, con xin cảm ơn.
So, dear Thay, dear Sangha, so we'd like to invite all the children to come out to follow me and the monastics. And if there's any children under six, we'd like to invite the parents to come with your children. So we'll wait out here the children, and they can follow me. Thank you.
This is a happy moment, a wonderful moment. The Sangha has the Sangha coming from Plum Village has spent almost 2 months and a half in North America. We have given many retreats, one in Canada, Brock University, we have also offered a retreat in Blue Cliff Monastery for English speaking people. We also have offered a retreat in English at the Magnolia Grove Monastery in northern Mississippi. And there we also was able to offer a retreat for Vietnamese speaking people. And then we came to Deer Park, and we have finished a retreat for Vietnamese speaking people and also a retreat for English speaking people. And this is this mindfulness, day of mindfulness, is the last event in the south, southern part of California. We went to Boston because Harvard University organized 2 days of practice for doctors, psychotherapists, and helping health professionals. And the School of Medicine and the School of Public Health helped organize these 2 days of practice. Many doctors and psychologists came and practiced with us during 2 days. We went to Washington, D.C. To give 2 days of practice at the World Bank. And many people participated in the event, and they were so happy. In the beginning, they were a little bit suspicious. Why bring Buddhist monks into the World Bank? But the president of the World Bank, he knew about the benefit of the practice, so he was determined to invite us anyway. He's very brave. uh, once he talked to the press and he said that the best book he enjoyed is The Miracle of Mindfulness. And he had profited a lot from the practice given by the book The Miracle of Mindfulness. So Brother Fablu, who is an American Buddhist monk, Dharma teacher, he had been in the university where Dr. Kim was president, and he wrote a letter to Dr. Kim at the World Bank to see whether he would like to have a day of practice of mindfulness in his bank. And Mr. Kim wanted very much, but he was a little bit afraid of the reaction within the bank. So he asked his associate, Dr. Nicholas, to try to arrange. I trust that you can arrange so that we will have a day of practice in the World Bank. And Mr. Nicholas went to the web and made research about Plum Village and mindfulness practice. And then he consulted his wife, and his wife said, well, bringing the Plum Village monks to the World Bank, that is the best thing the World Bank can do. So he was decided to write a letter of invitation. And the first day was a dialogue between a scientist and Thay about the benefit of the practice of mindfulness. That is a way to say that you are doing something very scientific and not religious. And then the second day is full of participants. Everyone was very happy. Then we went to Boston, to New York. And there is an exhibition of Thay's calligraphy in New York. And the exhibition will go on for 4 months. And every day many, many people come and visit. So today we are on the last day of practice together in Deer Park. Tomorrow we shall go to Northern California. There will be 3 events. One is with the Google employees. And they will stream the talk to Google employees all over the world. They wanted us to share our insight about intention, the motivation, the insight, and the innovation. They are very successful as a company, as a corporation, but still they need a spiritual dimension into the life and work. They wanted very much to learn how to balance between life and work, because people are so busy today. We do not have enough time to live, and we use most of our time just for working and making money, and people suffer. There will be a group of CEO of the big companies also would like to spend a day with Thay in order to inquire about these problems also. And finally, Stanford University wanted Thay to come and share about the practice of compassion, because there were scientists, especially in the neuroscience domain. They wanted to study compassion from the point of view of science. And they wanted to share with them the practice of mindfulness, of compassion, how to generate energy of compassion in order to heal and to make people heal, not only their mind, also their body. they have found out that compassion has the power to heal things like inflammation and so on. And on the 28th, we will fly back to Plum Village and begin our 3-month winter retreat. The psychotherapist talk about compassion fatigue. Because doctors, psychotherapists, they have to serve many people, they have to listen to the suffering of so many people. And if they do not know how to nourish and to heal themselves, they cannot go very long, very far. If you don't know how to nourish yourself, how to allow nature to heal you and to nourish you, if you do not know how to create a feeling of joy, a feeling of happiness, to nourish you and your family, and then you do not have enough resource to continue. Even if you have the capacity to listen to the suffering of other people, you get tired after a number of years because you just do one thing, touching the suffering of people, listening to the people, and one day you have no resource left. And you do not have the nourishment you get in order to produce the energy of compassion, because compassion is an energy. It's like light. You have to produce light. So compassion should be continued to be produced by our practice. Every breath, every step can help produce the energy of compassion. And you need also to have moments of joy and happiness in your life. If there is no joy and happiness, and then you don't have enough materials in order to feed your compassion. And that is why it's very important for people in the health profession to learn how to nourish themselves, to heal themselves if they want to continue helping people. Compassion is a kind of energy. And you should be able to produce that energy every day. Otherwise, you run away from your work. It's not because you don't know how to be compassionate, but you run out of the energy of compassion. Even if you know the goodness, the usefulness of compassion, and you are ready to be compassionate, but if you don't nourish your compassion, you will not have enough compassion to help you and help other people. So in these days, they have used the word compassion fatigue, which is funny in somehow. And they ask the question as whether too much compassion is good. Compassion is one of the 4 illimited energy. And if it is real compassion, it will never do something negative. Compassion can only nourish and heal. The problem is whether you still have compassion. Are you run out of compassion because you are so tired? You don't have enough nourishment for yourself. Compassion fatigue. Empathy fatigue. These terms have been born in the circle of therapists in these last few years. We know that in every one of us, there is suffering, even loneliness, suffering, anger, despair, and worries. But most of us do not have the time to handle, to take care of the pain in us. The reasons are of two kinds. The first reason is that we do not have the time. We have so many things to do. We do not have the time to take care of ourselves and to heal ourselves. The second reason is that we feel that it's not a pleasant thing to do, to go home to ourselves and try to sort it out, try to handle the suffering inside. We are afraid that if we go home to ourselves, we will be in touch with the pain, the suffering, the fear, the anger, the despair in us, and we will be overwhelmed by it. Most of us feel like that. We are afraid of ourselves. We are afraid of our own suffering. And that is why we try to run away from ourselves, from our suffering. We try to forget. If someone goes and opens the refrigerator and finds something to eat, that may not be because she is hungry, but because she feels that while eating something, she may forget for some time, the loneliness, the suffering, the pain in her. So eating is not because you are hungry, but because you want to cover up the pain, the suffering, the loneliness inside. The same thing is true with reading newspapers or a magazine, watching a film, or having a conversation. And we use all these things in order to run away from ourselves and to cover up the suffering inside. So the fact is that our civilization is a kind of civilization where people are trying to run away from themselves. They do not have the time to go back and to try to heal themselves. And they're afraid of going home to themselves in order to try to handle and to heal themselves. That is one characteristic of our civilization. And if we do not know how to heal ourselves, how can we help the people we love to do it? So why you run for yourself, you run away from yourself, you run away from your family and for your beloved ones? And then there are so many electronic gadgets produced by these big corporations to help you to do what? To run away. There are children who spend more than 8 hours playing electronic games. And maybe they are so lonely. Their parents are so busy and maybe not pleasant enough. So they take refuge in the electronic games. During the last question and answer session here for the retreat, in the retreat for English-speaking people, a teenager came and asked that question. At least I spent 8 hours with electronic games and I feel tired. But I cannot do otherwise. It's really that he was taking refuge in the games. Because in touch, he does not know how to be in touch with parents, friends, and nature. He does not get the nourishment and the healing from nature, from parents, from friends, from teachers, and so on. That is the situation of many young people. And why they spend the time to consume, they make the situation more serious. Because what they consume can be full of negative things like anger, violence, fear. So why you play electronic game or why you watch a film, you experience fear, anger, violence, because these things are appealing. You are curious to know what will happen at the end of the story. And they touch the seed of anger, of violence, of fear in you. And these things already are in our consciousness, and they are being watered every day by what we consume. Even conversation can be toxic, because what the other person say may be full of despair and anger. And if you spend 1 hour listening to him or to her, you got that toxin into your body and to your mind. So the items that we purchase, we use in order to cover up our suffering, they also have toxins and poisons. And day by day, we make the suffering in us grow, grow and grow. And we do not know how to handle the suffering inside. We are afraid of going home to ourselves. And not being able to help ourselves, how can we help and take care of our beloved one? And if you suffer so much, the other person will suffer with you. And if two people suffer, they may not be able to communicate. If you are too angry, we do not have enough freshness and love and compassion. So anger blocks communication and we can no longer speak to each other anymore. And the producers of these electronic devices, they say that they bring people together. That's not true. Even if we have the best kind of telecommunication means, communication has become much more difficult than before. Father and son cannot talk to each other. Partner and partner cannot talk to each other anymore. We are so lonely. And that is why we take refuge in these items, especially the young people. Business leaders, they do the same. They are so eager to succeed in their work. They want to become number one in their domain. And that is why they invest all their times and energies into their work. And they do not have the time to be to be with themselves. They do not know, they do not understand the suffering in them. They don't know how to handle the suffering in them. They do not have the time for themselves, and they do not have the time for their family. Dr. Kim of the World Bank, he told us that he go home to his family every day at 6 o'clock. Even if the work is overwhelming, he has made a decision to leave his office and go back to his family. And that is one of the good commitments. You got to have the time with your family. You should be there for them. You should be able to inquire about their suffering, their difficulties. You should share about your suffering, your difficulties. Because if communication is lost, and then no happiness, no harmony can be there anymore. And many business leaders, they do not have the time for their family. Frederick, who was a successful young businessman in Germany, he told his wife, Laura, that no one can replace him now. He needs about 3 years in order to find a person who can replace him. Because Laura cried every night. She was so lonely. She's left alone. When she went to the hospital for a surgery, he could not come. And when the son Philip went to the hospital, he could not come either. She was trying to do social charity work in order to forget her loneliness, but that didn't work. He promised her that in 3 years he would have more time for her and for their son. But one month later, he got killed in a car accident. And they replaced him in 3 days. And there are many Fredericks in our city, in our town. They should be able to learn from that. And Laura came to one of our retreats organized for business leaders, and she told us her story, the story of her husband. There is a belief that happiness is not possible if you do not have a lot of money, if you do not have enough power, social recognition. Or fame. So many of us are running after these objects of our craving because we believe that without these four things, wealth, fame, power, sensual pleasures, happiness is not possible. Because many people believe like that is why we believe like that also. But if we look deeply, around us, we see that there are so many people running after these four objects of craving, they destroy the body, the mind. They harm the body and the mind because they do not have the time to heal, to nourish themselves. And those who have already got plenty of these four things, they continue to suffer. The rich people, they suffer quite a lot. And many of them think of suicide. So it's true that these four things are not really components of true happiness. Wealth, sensual pleasure, fame, power. And then there is also that feeling, maybe it's not good. It's evil to have a lot of money. Is it good to have a lot of money while people are hungry? And people have the feeling of insecurity if they don't have some money in reserve. They think of money, stocks, are crucial for their safety. That will assure their well-being. So there is fear that if you don't have money, you are in danger. But we have learned that compassion is the kind of the energy that can protect us much better than money. In the time of Buddha, there was a famous businessman. His name is Anattapindika. He met the Buddha in the town of Jaragraha and became a student of the Buddha. So he invited the Buddha to go to his city, Shravasti, in the north of the Ganges River and teach. And he bought a park from a prince offered to the Buddha as a practice center, like a deer park. And he enjoyed coming for Dharma talks, days of mindfulness, and so on. He was so generous. He always gave. He helped. He supported orphans, poor people, old people, destitute people, and people in the city of Sarvasti loved him so much. The name Anattapindika was given him by the people in the city. It means that one who takes care of the destitute people. His real name is Sudatta. He helped so many people. He had a lot of friends. That's why once when he was bankrupt, he did not suffer. Once he went bankrupt, and he did suffer because his friend came and helped him rebuild his business. And one day, he brought to the Jeta Park a few hundreds of business leaders. And on that day, the Buddha gave them a kind of teaching aimed at business leaders. The Buddha said, "Gentlemen, it is possible to be happy in the here and the now. You don't need to run into the future to have that success in order to be happy. If you know how to go home to the here and the now, and recognize the many conditions of happiness available already in the here and the now, happiness can be there right away." And that sutra is very famous. The theme of the sutra is living happily in the present moment. And an expression, living happily in the present moment. Drishta Dhamma Sukha Vihara was mentioned 5 times in the sutra. I think the Buddha understood the mentality of business leaders. They think that these people, they think too much about the future, about their success. They don't know that happiness is possible in the here and the now. He said that, gentlemen, you can be happy right here, right, and right now if you know how to practice the 5 mindfulness trainings and the 4 recollections. The 4 recollections is recollection of the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha, and the mindfulness trainings. And that sutta is available, I think, in the chanting book of Plum Village. One of the questions they ask is how to balance life and work. You work too much, you don't have the time to live and to nourish yourself. People in big companies, they always ask the question. And one person may have many things to do at the same time, multi-task. The answer given time by the Buddha is simple. Suppose you, from the parking lot, from your parking lot, you walk to your workplace, your office. How do you walk? Because you have to walk there anyway. There may be 100 meters or less or more. You have to walk there. You cannot bring the car into your office. So how do you walk? You can do quickly. You say that you want to save time, so you run. Because walking like that is part of the work. Or if you know the art of mindful walking, you walk differently. And you take the time to enjoy every step. You stop the thinking, especially thinking about your business, your success. You allow yourself to be free from your thinking. You focus your attention on your in-breath, your out-breath, and the step you make. Breathing in, you make 2 steps, and you say, I have arrived, I have arrived. I have arrived in the here and the now, which is where you can find true life, because life is available only in the here and the now. The past is already gone, and the future is not yet there. So it's very simple that life and all the wonders of life that are nourishing and healing is only available in the present moment. And if you keep thinking about the future, and then you miss life, your appointment with life is in the here and the now. And if you do not go back to the here and the now, you miss your appointment with life. This is very serious. Your appointment with life is not in the cemetery. It's now here. It's here and now. So every breath, every step should be able to bring you home to the here and the now, so that you can get in touch with the wonders of life that can heal you, that can nourish you. You have to walk anyway, but choose the best way of walking. Walk like a Buddha and heal yourself with every step. A business leader can do like that. A employee in a corporation can do like that also. You should train yourself. We should train ourselves in walking like that. Because all of us have the tendency, the habit of running. And that habit of running, leaving the present moment behind, that habit might have been transmitted to us by our father, our mother, or our ancestors. Now, as we have encountered the Dharma, we have to change for our sake and for the sake of our ancestors. We don't want to run anymore. We have been running all our life. So once you can stop and touch the wonders of life in the present moment, all our ancestors in us can do the same and can enjoy the here and the now with the wonders of life. And it is not difficult at all. Some training and then you are able to walk like a Buddha and enjoy every step. Every step is healing. Every step is nourishing. Last May in Hong Kong, we had a retreat for 1,300 people in Hong Kong. Most of the people in Hong Kong, they do not drive to their workplace. They take train or bus. On the last day of the retreat, I told the audience that in the last 30 years, during the last 30 years, I have not used the telephone. And yet, I have not lost my communication with my friends and disciples. I can always be there for them. I practice listening to them. I practice being there for them. I have never lost contact with the younger generation, even if I do not have a telephone. And if all of them have had received the 5 mindfulness trainings, and there is a teacher-student's relationship. And I said, dear friends, if you want to be connected with me, you don't need a telephone, because I don't use a telephone. But if in the morning, leaving your home and walking to the bus station or the train station, if you walk like I do, to enjoy every step, to nourish yourself every step, every breath, stop thinking and walk like a free person. Stop completely the running and enjoy every step. You experience freedom, release, ease, happiness, and joy. Because if you know how to get in touch with the wonders of life, you allow nature to nourish you and to heal you. Walking like that is touching the earth. Bhumi Sparsha, touching the earth. Touching the earth can help heal you and heal the earth. And with every step you can touch Mother Earth to heal yourself and help heal Mother Earth. There are congressmen and senators in Capitol Hill who do walking meditation, because we have offered 2 retreat for them. And they wrote us and say that from their office to the going to the place where they cast the vote, they always use the techniques of mindful walk. They stop fully, entirely their thinking. They just focus the attention on their breath. And they reported that they can survive the hectic life of a politician by that way. Walking alone can already help. Imagine if you have other practice also. So, if from your home, walking to the train station or bus station, you walk like that, you know that Thay, you are having communication with Thay, because Thay always walk like that. And the practice, it could help, because that communication, that student-teacher relationship can support you in your practice. And you know that when you walk like that, Thay is walking with you. Thay is not in France only, he is everywhere. Thay is also in many prisons because he has help bring the teaching and the practice in many prisons, including the prisons in America. There are inmates who read Thay's book and do walking meditation. So Thay is little bit everywhere. So if you do walking meditation, you know that Thay is walking with you, and you can get Thay's energy in order to help heal and transform your afflictions. And who among you, I ask, commit yourself to that practice, walking mindfully to the train station, the bus station, and everyone raise their hand. Now there are at least 1,300 people in Hong Kong. In the morning, they walk to that train station, bus station like that. And I think that alone can already have very much. A person not to be victim of stress, tension, and so on. I remember we gave a talk at the House of Lords in London. And after the talk, everyone joined us for a walking meditation. And everyone enjoyed. The walking meditation is very pleasant. It's very, very nourishing and healing. And no matter how short the distance is, you can always apply the method of mindful walking. They can prevent you to collapse under the burden of work and worry, because with every step, you can cultivate freedom and joy and happiness and healing. Every step is healing. Every step is freedom. Because walking like that, you are free from the past, the future, the projects. And when you are free, you can make better decisions. When you breathe in and make a step, mindfully, the thinking stops, and you have a lot of freedom. because the thinking goes on always. If you allow it to continue, there is a mental discourse going on and on and on, day and night. And it is possible to stop the mental discourse just by focusing your attention on your in-breath or out-breath. And if you are totally focused on your in-breath, the talking will stop. And then the worry and the fear about future can also stop because your mind is not on the future. And the sorrow and the regret concerning the past also stop because you are not focusing on the past. So you got a lot of freedom while you breathe mindfully. And if you want that freedom to continue, breathe out in mindfulness. And breathe in mindfulness again. And you can extend that kind of freedom as long as you want. And you know that with that kind of freedom, your decisions will be much better than if you make them under the influence of the fear, the regret, the uncertainty, the sorrow. The practice is simple but very effective. And we need a sangha. We need a teacher, we need a brother, we need a sister in the practice to remind us. That is why in the Buddhist tradition, to practice with the sangha is the best. Because the sangha is always there to remind us of practicing. Maybe we know all the practices, but we don't practice. And that is why taking refuge in the sangha is not a declaration of faith. It is a practical thing to do. Even the Buddha takes refuge in a sangha. Without a sangha, the Buddha cannot do much. I myself have learned the lesson. I always take refuge in a sangha. You have to walk anyway to your office, to your workplace. But you choose the best way to walk. And walking like that can give an example of the balance between life and work. We can think dualistically of the problem. How much time for work and how much time for life? But we can make work into life. We can work in such a way that while working we feel alive. And that is the answer of the Buddha. Suppose you are a business leader and you are seeing a director of another company. You want to talk to him in order to negotiate about collaboration in some way. That is work, right? But instead of trying to get the best result from the talk, you can make the meeting pleasant for you and for him. If you know how to be fresh and pleasant, and if you know how to enjoy the time with the other person, you transform the session of meeting into a practice. You do your best, in order for the hour you spend with him or her to be a pleasant time for you and for that person. You can cultivate compassion, understanding in you, and you can help water the seed of compassion and understanding in him. And that is work, but that is also life. And you can do that. It's like when you make a breakfast for your family. Breakfast is work. Washing the dishes is work. But according to this teaching, you can enjoy deeply the time you wash the dishes. I have written a book to show people how to wash dishes. And that book continued to sell in the last maybe 30 years, more than 30 years. The miracle, 43 years, the miracle of mindfulness. Among other things, how to wash your dishes and enjoy the time. Imagine you are giving the baby Buddha a bath. It's wonderful to be standing here. You have the hot water, the cold water, the soap, everything in order to make you happy while doing the dishes. Joy and happiness is possible. Enjoy your breathing, smiling, you are alive, and you are doing that for yourself and your family out of love, and the time is a wonderful time. If you take a shower, you can make the time of shower taking a wonderful time. When you brush your teeth, don't try to finish as quickly as possible. To enjoy, you spend 1 or 2 hours, two minutes. You spend 1 or 2 minutes brushing your teeth. I always enjoy brushing my teeth. I remember that now, at this age, I still have some teeth to brush. So, defecating, urinating can also be very pleasant if you bring mindfulness into it. So when you listen to a colleague, because in a company you need to have good communication with your colleagues and employees. As a good director, executor, executive, you should know how to listen. You inquire about their health, their physical, family situation, financial problems. Because if you show that you care about their well-being, and then you have a good employee, he's a co-worker with you. If you can win him as a friend, win her as a friend. So a good executive should be able to have the time first for himself and for his families, and then he will bring that practice into his company. He can listen with compassion to his associate, his colleague, because listening like that helps the other people suffer less and restore communication and make the other people supportive of your work. You have to tell him, tell her about your motivation. I'm motivated by the desire to help the world. My aim, my principal aim is not making money, although we can make a lot of money, but that is not my major aim. My major aim is that people are running from themselves, running then for the family, running from away from nature. And we would like to run our business in such a way that help people to have the time to go back to themselves, to their families and to nature to get the healing. So I want you to know that this is my desire, my deepest desire. And a good corporation is a corporation where people have the same kind of intention of desire. Hugo wanted Thay to speak about intention first. Intention is one of the four nutriments by the Buddha. And maybe I will talk to them about the four nutriments. The first nutriment is edible food. Đoàn thực. And the Buddha advised us to eat in such a way that can help preserve compassion in ourselves. Because without compassion, a person cannot be a happy person. Without compassion, without love, you are utterly alone. You cannot relate to any other living being. And that is why we should eat in such a way that can preserve the energy of compassion in us. And he told the story of a couple of refugees who tried to flee the country to take refuge in another country. But the couple did not calculate well. That is why half through the desert they cross, they run out of food. They have brought with them their son, their little boy. And they knew that all of them would die in the desert. So after reflection, they made a terrible, painful decision to kill the little boy, to eat his flesh, and to survive as a couple with the hope of getting out of the desert. And then they will try to have another son or daughter later on. And each time they ate one morsel of that flesh, they beat their chest, they pulled their hair, and they asked, "Where is he now, our beloved little boy?" They suffer a lot. But finally they got out of the desert and they were accepted as refugees in the other country. The story must have been told by that couple to the Buddha. After having told the monks the story, he asked them, "My dear friends, do you think that the couple enjoy eating the flesh of their son?" The monk said, "No, dear teacher, it's impossible to enjoy eating the flesh of your own son." And the Buddha said, "In that case, let us eat in such a way that can preserve the compassion in our heart. Otherwise, we will be eating the flesh of our sons and daughters every day." And in fact, we are doing that because the amount of grain that we use to make alcohol is enormous. And why millions of people are dying because of the lack of food. If you stop making alcohol, that huge amount of grain, can help save many people from dying. So while you hold your glass of liquor, drink it mindfully. Otherwise, you will be drinking the blood of your own daughters, because many of them are dying now. According to UNESCO, many tens of thousands of children die every day because of the lack of nutrition and food. And the meat industry has destroyed much of our ecosystem. In order to make a piece of meat, you have to sacrifice a lot of forest, water. You pollute the earth, you pollute the air, the water, and so on. And Mother Earth suffer a lot because we continue to eat meat, red meat. We have learned that eating meat is more polluting than driving a car. And that is why a scientist told us that if we know how to reduce the eating of meat and the drinking of alcohol by 50%, we can already change the world. And that's why many years ago, Thay have made an appeal for the people in Vietnam to make the vegetarian days of each month into 15 days. Many already observe 10 days of eating vegetarian. So adding 5 days is quite easy for them to do. So the recommendation of the Buddha, we should eat in such a way that can help preserve compassion in us, is to be listened by all of us if we want to care about Mother Earth and other living beings. The second source of nutriment is sense impression. Xúc thực. And this kind of food we consume by the way of the eyes, the ear, the nose, the tongue, the body, and the mind. We have spoken about this already when we read an article in a magazine. We consume. When we have a conversation, we consume. When we play an electronic game, we consume. When you go to the internet, you consume. When you watch a film, read a book, you consume. And they are not good food if they contain a lot of toxins and poisons. Because what you consume may be full of violence, anger, and fear, and despair. That's why there should be a good strategy of consumption so that we can protect ourselves, protect our family and our society. Because many items available in the market, they are full of toxins. They are selling these things to us to help us cover up the suffering inside of us. We need to consume in order to cover up the suffering in ourselves, including electronic gadgets. We buy because they know that we need to run away from ourselves. So they continue to make money, and we continue to run away from ourselves using these kind of items, of objects. So the question here is how to consume that we can go home to ourselves and take care of ourselves and restore health, physical health and mental health and family health and the health of Mother Earth. The third source of nitman is volition. Tư niệm thực. This is what the Google executive speaker, they use the word intention. What is our intention? What is our purpose? What is our motivation in the underlying the corporation? What is the purpose of a corporation? Is it to make money, or it is for something else than money? The unofficial intention of Google is do not be evil. Do not do something evil while getting rich. And many corporations want to do some charity work in order to feel less bad. But is that enough? What is your real intention? And volition is the kind of deepest desire you have. What do you want to do with your life? We have daily concerns, like how to have a house to live in, how to have the money to pay for our house, how to send our son to college, how to have good health, how to have a partner that can understand us, support us. And these are daily concerns about material comforts and affective comforts. But do we have other concern that is not daily concern, ultimate concern? What do we want to do with our life? So a partner should have the time to sit with her partner and say, "Darling, what is your dream? What do you want to do with your life? Please tell me. Please share it with me." Of course, we need the daily things, practical things, but we do need also this because it makes the life of a person meaningful. And if a daughter sits with her father, a son with his father, and asks, "Daddy, when you were young, what was your dream? What kind of thing you want to realize? What did you want to do with your life? Can I help you? Can I continue you?" And when we walk, we talk like that, we can communicate well because you touch the deepest thing in your father, in your partner. We should not only talk about the daily concern, we should about the real volition. The Buddha also has a deep desire. He saw people suffer so much. He wanted to practice and be free, and help other people. So he is nourished by that kind of nutriment, volition. If you have that kind of desire in you, you have a lot of energy. The terrorists, they have a strong desire to punish, to kill, in the name of justice, or in the name of God. But that is not good food. Because if you are you are fed with wrong perceptions and anger and the desire to kill, to punish, that is not good volition, that's not good food. And for corporate leaders, I'm going to tell them that now if you look at humanity, a civilization, you see that most of us are running away from ourselves, from our family and from nature. could you run your business in such a way that can help us go home? Your business should embody that kind of practice. From the chief executive to his associate and employees, everyone should have the time to take care of themselves. Should do their work in such a way by while doing the work, they enjoy it. It's like you walk to your office with walking meditation, you enjoy it. You don't see walking to your office as something you must do, but you can enjoy. Seeing a guest or talking to your employees, you can make that time into life. Every work can be life at the same time. So a good corporation is a corporation where everyone is working and living at the same time. They enjoy what they are doing. In Plum Village, we organize many retreats and days of mindfulness. And we learn how to enjoy organizing. We do not want to lose ourselves in the work. You know that in Plum Village or in Deer Park, no one of us has a private house. No one has a private bank account. No one has a salary. But we are a true corporation because we have one purpose. We want to help people to suffer less, to restore communication, to reconcile, to transform. And that is our intention, that is our volition. And we make known to that to everyone. If you join us, not because of other things, but because you share the same kind of intention. And with that, you can organize your life in such a way that you have the time for yourself. You have the time for each other. In Plum Village, we are many hundred people in Deer Park, in other practice centers, the same. We do have the time to sit together, to walk together, to eat together, to discuss together, and to listen to each other. And we have the time to build brotherhood and sisterhood. And we are nourished by that kind of brotherhood and sisterhood. We feel very, very safe, even if we don't have a lot of money. We don't feel that money can assure our safety. It is compassion, it is the Sangha, it is brotherhood and sisterhood that are security. It's like anatapenika, compassion, brotherhood, friendship is our safety, protecting us. And every time we organize a retreat and see people transforming, healing, That is what we want to produce. That is our product. And the transformation and the healing of the people are nourishing us. We are nourished by our volition. If volition is a tremendous source of energy, and in Buddhism we call bodhicitta, bodhitam, the mind of love, the mind of enlightenment. And every practitioner has to nourish his or her bodhicitta in order to have energy to continue. As a monk, as a nun, as a lay teacher, and a lay practitioner. So we are a corporation, even if we are not making money. We are producing mindfulness. We are producing concentration, insight. We are producing compassion. Because these things cannot be bought in the supermarket. So building a Sangha is to produce these valuable things. And if we have a strong desire. And then, yeah, we have got enough nourishment, got enough energy to do it. So I am going to tell them, corporate leaders, that the most important thing is to have, you have a good motivation. The purpose of your corporation is not to make money, to be socially recognized, to have power, but to help people to suffer less, helping them to go home and take care of themselves. And you begin with your corporation. Your corporation should become a sangha where brothers and sisters are taking care of yourself. And based on that kind of foundation, you are producing, you are doing your work. And if you can do like that, making money is not something bad at all. Because with that money, you know how to use in order to help people suffer less. And that is a good volition, good food. And you have to share your volition, your motivation, your desire with everyone in the corporation. And you become a sangha, a community of brothers and sisters working together with the same kind of aim. And the last source of nutriment is called consciousness. Thức thực consciousness as food, because we consume our own consciousness, we consume our the collective consciousness of a group. In the Buddhist teaching, our consciousness is made of two parts. And the lower part is called a store consciousness. And the upper part is called a mind consciousness. Down here, there are many seeds of goodness. You have a seed of mindfulness, you have a seed of concentration, you have a seed of insight, you have a seed of love, compassion, loving kindness, non-violence, joy. They are down here. There are good things in our consciousness. And if you know how to, they will help them, they will water them, so they will go up here as energies. Down here, the name is Bija, means seed. Chủng tử. And when they manifest up here as energy, they are called mental formation. Citta samskara. So a good practitioner knows how to recognize the good seeds in him and try to water them every day so that they come up here. They make the landscape of the mind beautiful. And they nourish their love, their mindfulness, their concentration, their joy. And they know how to touch these good things in the consciousness of their partner. They make him or her happy. They are consuming our own consciousness. everyone has this kind of wonderful, good seeds. In Vietnamese, we call it thiền căn, the good roots. Thiền căn ở tại lòng ta. The good roots are in our consciousness. And at the same time, we have negative seeds also here. Anger, fear, despair, loneliness, violence, and so on. And if you allow people to water these seeds, they will come up here. And you suffer. That is not good food. So as partners, husband and wife, father and son, mother and daughter, we have to sit down together and discuss about this practice. Darling, you know that I have good seeds in me. I have the seed of mindfulness, compassion, joy, forgiveness in me. And if you know how to touch them and help them to manifest, I'll be happy. And if I am happy, you happy too. So I promise that in my daily life, I try my best to water these beautiful seeds in me. That is good food for me. And I beg you to do the same, because I do have these good seeds. And if you can say something or do something to touch these seeds, they go manifest and make me happy. That is good, good food. And I promise to do the same. I know that, my darling, you also have these wonderful seeds in you. And I promise that every day I try to recognize them and water them so that they will manifest up there and make you happy. When you are happy, I am happy also. That's good food. But darling, you know I have also the negative seed. If I water them by reading bad books, watching the wrong film, having the wrong conversation, I touch off these seeds in me, I suffer. So I make the vow that I will not consume these negative elements in my consciousness. And you help me. Every time you see me caught in that, you try to help me go out and touch the better things in me. I promise to do the same thing with you. I will never touch off the seed of anger and fear and despair in you. And you promise me that you will not do it for yourself. And in everyone, there is a dark corner in our consciousness. We may have been wounded in the past, may have been abused as a child in the past. And the suffering of the past is always there, and we have not been able to transform them because no one has helped us. The practice is that every time the past go back and show itself, we have to recognize it and embrace it with mindfulness in order to calm it down and to transform it. But most of us do not do so. We tend to go back to the past and stay in that dark corner and continue to watch the film of the suffering in the past again and again and again. And that is not good food, to stay in the past and to live and really re-experience the pain that we had experienced in the past. So if you are a good partner, help her, help him to get out of that dark spot in consciousness. Make her touch the present moment, which is beautiful and healthy. And help her to practice in such a way that she can transform that dark place in her consciousness into a bright place. Because suffering is also organic. We can transform it into into something more positive, like the garbage made into compost to nourish the flowers. That is the fourth kind of nutriment. We consume our own consciousness. And then there is the collective consciousness that sometimes not healthy at all to consume. There are neighborhoods that are full of anger and despair and violence. If our children and ourselves live in that part of the city, we will consume negative things. Their way of speaking, their way of acting, is full of anger, of hate, of violence. And if we allow ourselves and our children to be there for a long time, we consume, and one day we will do exactly like them. We know that when we come together like this, as a Sangha, and breathe mindfully, and produce a compassion, that is a collective good food. It's very healing, the collective energy of mindfulness and compassion and joy. But the collective energy of anger, of fear, is very destructive. And if you notice that you are living in such an environment, you should try to pull out as quickly as possible, because you don't want to consume that kind of collective consciousness. It's very dangerous. And if we know how to build a good sangha, a healthy community, you can come back and help them transform. And that is why the practice to heal ourselves is very important. If you are a mayor, if you are in the city council, you should think about that. You should help these neighborhoods to transform. You have to invite good people in the city to come and discuss about strategy in order to help create the kind of collective energy that can be healing and transforming. And you are responsible for the well-being of your city. So you should have a right view, a clear view about four kinds of nutriments. If you want your city, your country to suffer less, to experience happiness. Yesterday, in the public talk, I talked about, I gave an example of work and life. If we have a non-dualistic of insight about work and life, and then every minute working is also a minute of living. And I use the example, because every day I do a little bit of calligraphy, and I do the calligraphy in such a way that it is not work, it is life. I always begin my practice of calligraphy by having a cup of tea. And you know, you saw this morning how I drink my tea. I took the time to drink my tea. I drink my tea in such a way that I'm aware of the clouds that are present in my tea. I'm aware that many clouds are already in my body. I'm made of at least 70% of cloud. And I mix, I always mix some ink with my, some tea with my ink. So when you look at my calligraphy, you can see tea inside. When I draw a circle, I begin to breathe in. And while breathing in, 3-4 seconds, I draw the first half of the circle. So there is mindfulness. is my breathing inside. And when I breathe out, I finish the other half of the circle. And I spend about four, five, or six seconds finishing. And I smile. So that is work, but that is life. Very often I invite my teacher or my father to draw the circle with me. And during that time of drawing the circle, I see them fully alive, and this hand is their hand also. Sometimes I invite my students to do it with me. And that is not only work, but also life. Not only life and work, but also practice. Everything you do is the practice of meditation. Whether you are sweeping the floor, whether you are brushing your teeth and cooking the dinner for your family or for the community, that is practice. In Plum Village, I always tell the monastics there are four aspects of their life. First of all, practicing meditation. Second, studying, learning Buddhism and other things. Every day you should practice, you should learn. Every day you should work, you should do the work. Everyone has to do the work. And the fourth is to play, to enjoy. You play basketball, table tennis, volleyball, any kind of play. Because we have to build brotherhood and sisterhood. And you practice in such a way that there must be joy and play during the practice. Like sitting meditation. Sitting meditation should be pleasant, should be enjoyable, and not hard work. And if you suffer during sitting meditation, that's not the right practice. You practice sitting meditation or walking meditation in such a way that there is a joy, happiness during the time you sit and you walk. Like this morning, we did not have to suffer at all when we walk like that. In fact, we experience joy and peace with every step. So joy must be there during the practice. Joy should be there during the learning. You should make the classroom joyful. Life is there during the practice, during the learning. And life should be there also during the time you work. Sometimes the monastics have to cook for 1,300 practitioners coming. Of course, they have other people to help them. But they learn how to do it with joy, with love. Life should be there during the work. And work, if work is only work, that's not worth doing that. You organize your work in such a way that you experience joy and well-being during the time you work. And you arrange so that you have plenty of time to do so. And the way I do calligraphy, you should be able to enjoy what you are doing. Taking a shower, mopping the floor, washing the dishes, should be pleasant. And that is the practice of mindfulness. So if we can do like that as a community of practice, and then people in the corporation can do like that. They have to study to learn more. They have to do a lot of work. they have to allow themselves to be relaxed, to be nourished, and therefore we can do very much in the same way. If you want your family, if you want your business, if you want to your corporation to be healthy, to be joyful, and the practice of help, of mindfulness can help. So learning how to release the tension from your body, learning how to create a moment of joy and happiness, learning how to handle a painful feeling or emotions, learning how to speak and to listen in such a way that you can restore communication and reconcile, that is what we should learn. Parents should learn, school teachers should learn, heads of corporation should learn in order to succeed. And you do not have to be a Buddhist in order to do all these things. Anyway, Buddhism is made of non-Buddhist elements. And each of us, with the practice of mindfulness, can begin anew to rebuild ourselves, rebuild our health, rebuild our happiness and well-being. And then we can help rebuild the happiness and well-being of our family. And we can help rebuild Mother Earth. And this is a good direction. And corporate leaders should also share the same kind of volition of motivation. And the next thing we do is to have a mindful lunch. Eat in such a way that not only our body be nourished, but our mind, our consciousness be nourished by compassion, joy, brotherhood, and sisterhood. While eating, you do not think, because the thinking takes you away from the here and the now. While eating, you focus your attention on the food and on the presence of brothers and sisters in the practice that are around you. And eating in such a way, we can nourish only our body, but also our mind, our consciousness, and build the sangha.